School plans announced in Victoria and New South Wales have been met with mixed reactions from parents and teachers, many fearing the demand for multiple weekly rapid tests to be too much for students.
Joining us with more is Shadow Minister for Education and Training, Tania Plibersek in Sydney. Nice to see you this morning, Tania. Are you comfortable with kids going back to school despite low vaccination rates?
Look, I think it's really important to take the best medical advice on this. Parents are really worried, and they're worried that their kids have missed out on a lot of schooling over the last 2 years. They don't want to keep them home any longer than is necessary, but they're worried about kids going back into classrooms because, of course, the paediatric vaccine rollout has been too slow, and that stresses parents. So that's why today Labor's announcing a $440 million plan to help our kids bounce back from COVID safely. We're talking about upgrades to classrooms to make sure the air quality is better, opening up windows, moving learning outside if that's possible, and also another boost for kids' well-being. Of course, they've missed out on learning their maths and reading and writing and all the rest of it, but they've missed out on so much more, you know, the sitting around with your mates at lunchtime, school sport, excursions, getting to know one another, growing up. So we've got a well-being boost in there for our kids as well.
OK, so are you promising $440 million in funding? It's ostensibly a state responsibility. You're saying they need the help, they have a shortfall there that needs to be plugged?
Well, we're saying that the federal government, the Commonwealth government, should work with the states and territories to make sure that our classrooms are safe for kids and for school staff, that the air quality is as good as it can be with ventilation, filtration systems, reopening painted over doors and windows to let in the fresh air, moving learning outside when we can. We want to help with that. And we think Scott Morrison really should have been planning for this stuff for months now. So we want to make sure the physical environment is safer, but we've also got...
But it is a state responsibility though, right?
Well, no, it's a shared responsibility. It's always been a shared responsibility. The fact is Scott Morrison walked away from school funding, including school funding for upgrading our schools. He cut that. He decided it wasn't his responsibility. Like a lot of stuff, he talks big and then he says to the states, well, you better fix it. We know it's a shared responsibility, and we want to partner with the states and territories to make sure that our classrooms are safer for kids and for school staff who are returning this year.
So are you saying that classrooms
sure that
currently
the
aren't safe?
Air quality is the best it can be.
Do you not think classrooms
no,
are
I'm
safe
saying
for kids
that,
to return?
No. No, I don't want to alarm people. What I'm saying is that the better the air quality, the more fresh air in there, the lower the risk of COVID transmission. And we know that some states have already invested in filters. We know that in a lot of older schools, the windows were nailed shut 30 years ago and painted over. We need to be able to open them up and get some fresh air in. We know that some schools have plenty of room in the playground, and we put up a few shade structures, and a lot of the learning can happen outside with kids having better social distancing and school staff getting more fresh air. These are simple measures. We should have been planning for this as part of the return to school. Scott Morrison could have been helping and showing leadership, but he hasn't. And then the other part of this, of course, is that kids have missed out on so much of their social development. Like all those school sports, excursions, 16th birthday parties, school formals that they've missed out on have really taken a toll, and parents see it in their kids. The surveys of parents talking about their families' well-being and mental health shows that many of them are very concerned for their kids. So we're setting aside extra funding for school counsellors, school psychologists and other well-being measures that would help our kids bounce back after COVID.
My daughter's got a school formal this year, year 12. I'm comfortable with her not attending.
Not going.
Tanya.
She may not be, though.
I bet you're a bit worried about schoolies as well. You're already worried about schoolies, aren't you?
Oh, no, let's talk about it.
No, but Labor abolishes schoolies, you know, you're going to get some votes.
You've got your vote there.
That's
okay. I think a lot of parents would vote for
that's
that.
It. That's it.
The plan to regularly test students across New South Wales and Victoria when school returns has been met with mixed emotions from parents. Some fear the testing regime will traumatise their children, while others are happy to do whatever it takes to get kids back in the classroom.
For more, we're joined by two families set to experience it all firsthand. Let's go first to Anne Neville with her three kids, Danielle, Catherine and Ted Decker in Sydney. Good morning to you guys. And to you, first of all, how are you feeling about your kids heading back to the classroom next week?
A little bit of fear, I suppose, is mixed in with the uniforms, the textbooks, the lunch boxes. But I think we just have to face the reality that Omicron's here, it's here to stay, it's moving through the community, and I just have to put our trust and faith in the decisions that are being made on our behalf, and that the school back to school plans, I guess you'd call them, COVID safe plans. Look, I read one the other day, 96 pages. So they've certainly got the kids in mind and their welfare, and what more can we really do?
There's a lot, isn't there? Hey, Daniel, you're heading into year 10. How are you feeling about it?
I'm excited for it, seeing what my senior year has in stock for me.
And Catherine, what about you? Are you nervous about all the testing that needs to be done?
For me personally, I'm not that nervous since I've already been tested and had the experience to, but yeah. I know others might be.
And look, and I know that Danielle and Catherine are both double vax, but Ted, your youngest isn't. You're waiting until he turns 12. I think that's something that, you know, a few families, that's discussions that are taking place in a lot of households. Mm. Does it make you nervous at all that he's heading back without that protection?
Yes and no. I call him the immunity king, so not much really phases him with ill health. But that aside, it is in the back of my mind. But look, the RAT tests are there. There's such good protocols in place with the hand sanitisation and just the mask wearing of all the teachers and the like. I've just got to have a bit of faith.
Daniel and Catherine, does it really annoy you that little Ted is referred to as the immunity king?
No, not really.
Yeah. Catherine's shaking.
No, not really.
Hey, can I ask
middle
this?
Child, Catherine, I get it.
And can I ask this? There's a lot of pressure on families right now. There's a lot of pressure on the decisions being made by parents. What has been the hardest aspect of you, for you, in that decision process?
Managing the fear.
Yeah.
I think I've been trying to just make myself as informed as I can be and then take decisions to myself, sift through them, what feels comfortable and what feels right for my family. Mm. And each of us, we're all individual and we have different viewpoints. And we have different medical concerns that we might be dealing with. We might have different emotional makeups of individuals as well. So we've just got to sift through it and just feel comfortable in yourself that you're making the right choice
for you, your family,
and your kids.
And how are you feeling about it? We're bringing now Samantha Stevens and her two kids, Alice and Will, there in Melbourne. Sam, you know, after what you guys have been through with countless lockdowns, how are you feeling about the kids going back and about getting the kids tested twice every week?
Oh, look, we're really keen to get them back in the classroom. I mean, I think we saw, as you mentioned, Ali, those prolonged lockdowns in Melbourne and the amount of school time that these kids missed, the amount of classroom time they missed, and the anxiety that caused them, you know, it just, I think it's just so important to get them back in the classroom and get them back around their friends. And, you know, each of these kids have had their first vaccination, and I know the school does an amazing job of keeping everything COVID safe. So we're feeling pretty enthusiastic, I have to say.
There's anxiety for parents on this decision-making on whether or not you want to have your kids vaccinated when they go back to school, and there's anxiety for parents who choose not to as well, and how they're going to be judged, how that's all going to work out. For you, what's been the hardest thing?
Look, for us, I mean, we were really keen to get the kids vaccinated, yeah. and I probably had some trepidation about them going back into the classroom without being vaccinated. So, you know, there was absolutely no questioning in my or their dad's minds about getting them jabbed as soon as they were eligible. And in fact, both kids were pretty keen as well.
Will, how are you feeling about heading back to school and seeing your mates?
Yeah, I'm pretty happy about it. Yeah, it's good. Lockdowns during remote learning, you felt really alone. The classroom environment really helps with not only learning, but socialising.
All those things. What are you most looking forward to back at school?
What am I most looking forward to back at school? Probably just seeing my friends again.
Yeah. Mm. I know the questions that Carlos asked are a real drag. Sorry about that, young fella. Hey, well done to you guys. Thank you for coming on the show. Really appreciate it. None of this is easy, and it's new territory. So we appreciate you coming on and sharing your experience. The big decisions that are being made all around the country, so thank you.
Yep, good luck with it, with day one.
Mm, it's hard, isn't it? I mean, you've got little Mac going to school. And
he's about to start school, you know, and there's a whole lot of stuff that comes with that. He would not have had his first vaccination by the time he starts, and that's something that we're, you know, I mean, it is what it is, but, yeah, there's plenty going on, and for when you've got lots of different kids and...
It's going to be one of those starts of the year, you can feel it, you know.
It's going to be disruptive, yeah. I think, but I just like the plan. I like the Victoria and New South Wales have the same plan. I think that sort of, as a parent, it gives you, you know, comfort to know that, everyone's worked together on this. I feel like politics hasn't played a role. Everyone's just trying to get the kids back in the classroom and keep everyone, including their teachers, safe.
My biggest worry is that we're going to go into the school year and they're going to be kids who are unvaccinated and their parents who are making that decision. That they don't want to vaccinate their kids. What sort of pressure and conflict is that going to bring about because of that decision making? And everyone needs to be patient with all of that.
Yeah.
I mean, just because a parent says, I don't want to get my child vaccinated, I think it's very different to the adult population.
Tricky. Yeah, I mean, Mac just turned five a couple of days ago, so for us it hasn't happened yet. And it's one of the conversations that we're having in the house like everyone else.
And is he worried about what sort of lunches mummy's going to make?
He's got good reason to be worried.